Good afternoon, everyone. I want to just thank Mrs. Steele and, of course, Dr. Steele for inviting me. I'm with the Fulton County District Attorney's Office, and I've been doing this work for the last 6-7 years. I've been a lawyer for over 22 years now, and I will say that this is my passion. This is my heart's work. People ask me all the time, you know, how is it that you can deal with this content on a day-to-day basis and maintain, you know, a healthy personal life? And all I can tell you is that, you know, I got a charge to keep and a God to glorify. That's all I can tell you. I want to also introduce to you guys my investigator. She came out too, Michelle Lamb. She's a senior investigator in the Human Trafficking Internet Child Exploitation Unit with me, and we serve together in that unit. Let me warn you now that I'm going to share some facts with you that may be difficult to hear. Matters of sex that may make you uncomfortable, but we're standing, I believe, in the precipice of a battle for the lives of our children in a society that has sexualized almost every relationship our young people encounter. The fact is, human trafficking is a $150 billion industry. According to a study done by Atlanta Women's Agenda, the sexual exploitation of children has become the third largest moneymaker outside of guns and drugs for organized crime. Traffickers are organized. They are in this to make money, to support their lifestyles, and they're creating victim after victim after victim. In fact, human trafficking, it doesn't just involve the trafficking of our children, but it involves the trafficking of our young adults, not only girls, but boys, all marginalized communities. And the thing about it is that it's hidden in plain view. It's right in front of us, but you really don't know what you're looking at. It's because it's behind a kind of closed door environment where this happens, you'll find that our kids and our young people are hidden behind massage parlors, escort businesses, dance clubs, even the boyfriend's home, even the auntie's home, even sitting in the pews of our congregation, okay? And so because Atlanta has a thriving adult sex industry with more than 40 adult clubs in Metro Atlanta alone, Atlanta has developed a reputation as a sexual tourist destination that attracts traffickers. But I want to dispel some myths that are commonly held. People tend to think that prostitution is a victimless crime. People tend to think that girls and even some boys want to participate in this willingly. And I'll let you know that's not been my experience in dealing with the numerous victims that we encounter. Sometimes we believe it's kidnapping or it's snatching or it's taking people. It's not always that. Most of the time, it's not that. I want to make sure I talk to you from my heart and about the work that we do, because what I'm seeing is not necessarily snatching off the streets. What I'm seeing is snatching off the internet. So this conversation, it should make us uncomfortable. It should make us so uncomfortable that we make a clarion call for us to come together and fight and unify to protect our most vulnerable. It's not that the district attorney's office can really prosecute our way out of this crime, out of these heinous acts. We're going to have to come together and do it together. Let me give you a few statistics. In 2022, Georgia ranked number 7 nationwide in human trafficking cases with over 8,000 victims reported. That's in just the state of Georgia. In 2023, the city of Atlanta ranks number 2 in cities across the country for human trafficking. Human trafficking is the fastest growing criminal industry in the world, the buying and selling of people. The average age of entry into the commercial sex trade is 14 to 15 years of age, with 1 in 6 being under the age of 12.
It's even younger for boys. The average entry age for boys is about 10 or 11. 71% of traffickers have more than one victim. They are running 3 to 5 girls at the same time, and again, are motivated by money, motivated by greed. 44% of survivors report that no one reached out to them or offered them any help while they were being exploited. 55% of survivors reported they attended school at some point during their exploitation and nobody knew about it. 90% of survivors report they met their exploiter while using social media, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, you name it. 55% met their trafficker while text or website or an app, meaning someone, as they say, slid into their DM or sent them a direct message on social media and groomed them, and it became a relationship that turned into something else. In our office, we're currently prosecuting 113 defendants. 66 of those defendants are charged with either sexual trafficking or labor trafficking, and 80 to 90% of those survivors that we work with met the trafficker online. Some of the sites. And with the onset of technology and the World Wide Web, see, back in the day, if you're from Atlanta, you know something about Fulton Industrial Boulevard.
Yep.
Old National Highway.
Yep.
They were considered the track. Girls would quote-unquote walk the track. I will suggest to you that the World Wide Web has brought the track into our homes. The internet has brought the track into our homes. So we're not going to see the girls necessarily on the street like we used to. They're on the internet. And traffickers are very savvy, and they know how to reach people and exploit people and pick out the vulnerabilities of people online. So I'm gonna debunk some myths. I know maybe some of us have seen the movie Taken, and that has really been like the thing I've been trying to debunk and demyth about human trafficking around the country. You can go to the next slide and play it.
Thank you. Good luck.
While this movie, I'm actually kind of grateful for, because it heightened our awareness that these types of things go on, that people can be taken and snatched, that people can be transported across country lines and trafficked and sold into sexual slavery or sexual servitude. But I want to bring this forward into 2024, and that while this may happen, this is not the majority of what we see in Fulton County. This is really not what we see, for the most part, across the country. What we are seeing is personal. Human trafficking is personal. Women and boys are groomed. Relationships are formed. Formed to a place where girls become reliant on their trafficker. In relationships where they believe that they're being loved. And so they stay in a cycle of violence, almost like domestic violence. And so that's what we're seeing. We're not seeing people snatched. We're seeing people snatched out of their homes, through their computers, through their websites, and even through personal relationships. So what is human trafficking? So I know we're gonna talk about sex trafficking today, but I just want you to be aware there are two types of trafficking. There's labor trafficking and sex trafficking. And we've handled both types of trafficking. Both are heinous, both are horrible, both exploit people for gain. So what is sexual servitude? It's anything where someone is trying to get some kind of sexual service in exchange for money or anything of value. I want you to understand that sex trafficking is not just money being exchanged. Sex trafficking has a lot to do with providing a person who's vulnerable with something of value in exchange for something. So when I say that, I have victims who said, well, I needed a prom dress. Someone offered me an opportunity to work. And when I worked, I made money to buy a prom dress. That's trafficking. Just because it doesn't look like typical pimping as we think it is. Anytime you use someone in exchange, you give them something in exchange for value. It could be shelter, it could be food, it could be clothing. In exchange for some kind of sexual act, that is trafficking. And what you find is in our communities, we have a lot of vulnerability. We have a lot of vulnerable people, not just children, people. People are really wed to their phones. They're wed to social media. They think that's reality. And they try to live a life that they see on a screen that ain't reality.
Right.
And then they find themselves in a situation that it's hard to get out of. For minors, they can't consent to it. The young lady that, you know, you may look at her, maybe she's not dressed appropriately. Do we know her backstory? Have we stopped to ask her, what's going on with your life? I'm so grateful to talk to Mrs. Steele and know what she's doing with young ladies to expose them to the proper way of living, proper way of moving forward in their lives. But most girls, a lot of girls that I deal with, don't have that benefit. They come from marginalized communities, places where parents aren't being parents. We talked about them in the last session, where parents aren't parenting, and or they're in de facto care. They're in care of the state. They're runaways. So we have to understand when we see kids that are involved with sex trafficking, sometimes we think, well, look at her. This is what she wants to do because she's with someone, and she's like, well, I'm doing my thing. But I've learned in dealing with these girls that no young lady says, when I grow up one day, I want to be a prostitute. When I grow up, I want to sell myself. No, we have to understand the backstory. That's what we do in my unit. I pound that in our heads. What is the backstory? What got them there? So we can understand how to get them out. Sex trafficking of a minor, it includes recruiting someone, harboring, meaning they live in your house. You didn't even have to recruit them. They live in your house, and they're committing these acts, and they're being trafficked. The person that has the ownership of that home can be prosecuted.
Right.
Transporting people, obtaining people, all of that. A child cannot consent to this. They can't. Even if they say, I want to, legally, no. Children need to be children. I don't have to prove that they were forced in it if they're a child. Now, if they're 18 or older, I have to prove that they were forced or coerced. In Atlanta, we see a lot of deception with that. So Atlanta is a big hub for entertainment, right? Music, movies, things like that. So our traffickers are like, well, come be in the video, come be in my music video, you're beautiful, let me take pictures of you, things like that. And that's how they're deceived. They're thinking, okay, I'm going in for a job, a modeling job, this person's going to help me pursue a career, and then they get here, and then the script is flipped on them, and now they're caught up in a life, and it's hard to get out. So what are the demographics? Let me just say this to you. There are no demographics. There are, but there aren't. The reason why I say that, because everybody's vulnerable. Everybody has a vulnerability. Just having met the person knows how to pinpoint it and exploit it. Financial means, not having money. Socioeconomic status is a vulnerability. Being a minor is a vulnerability. Homelessness. Sometimes our kids are hooked on whatever drugs, and they want the drugs, they want the weed, they want the whatever drug they're taking, and will do anything for it. That's a vulnerability. Traffickers have an uncanny knack for tapping in on vulnerability and exploiting it. Looking for love in all the wrong places. That's everywhere. Undocumented immigrants, unstable living conditions, also a history of domestic violence. If all you've seen in your life is a violent home, all you know is violence, when someone comes along and tries to show you love and they're a little bit kind to you, you're vulnerable. You're open. So there is no real demographic. I've had cases where the picture on the top right, it was a lady, young girl, who was working in a drive-thru at a fast food restaurant. And a guy drives to the drive-thru and thinks she's pretty and compliments her, and they exchange Instagram handles. Next thing you know, she's thinking she's in a relationship. Next thing you know, he's telling her, you gotta do this for the team so we can win, so we can come up. And she's like, I don't wanna do that. And now he's sexually assaulting her. He's forcing her into a life. She has no family here. She's not even from the state of Georgia. She's from somewhere up north. And now she's like, what do I do? And it wasn't until he drove her down some windy road, and then he took a gun and shot it out the window and told her, this is what you're gonna do, that she began to plan her way out. And we ended up getting that case. That case went to trial. He was convicted and sent to prison for life. Mm-hmm. I've got the girl who went to college. I've got the girl who was just in school. I've got all demographics. I've got the runaway. I've got the young boy whose mom was a single parent, and he was relying on the job that some man was giving him to help take care of his mother, who ended up wanting to have some kind of sexual relation with him for money. I mean, there's no demographic, it's the vulnerability. Can we identify the vulnerability that's being exploited? This case, and I always put this case in because people always think it's children. It is children. A lot of times it's children. But there's so many vulnerabilities. This case started where this young lady, actually he was about 33 years old, but no, 37 years old. She lived in North Georgia, had never been to Atlanta. She got on Facebook. She started corresponding with this guy. And it wasn't like an immediate connection. And he started talking. He started complimenting her, started telling her she was beautiful and all those things. She had just gotten a bad relationship with somebody. They started going back and forth. He was out after. He showed pictures where he's on this, in this place where he's on contract work, and she's thinking, okay, he has a job, I have a job, I have a family. And so now they're corresponding back and forth on Facebook. And one day he says, well, okay, we've been doing this for a while. Like, I want to say weeks, maybe a month. Won't you come down and visit? We should see each other finally. So she gets the Greyhound bus. They send this text message back and forth. And when you come down, I'll come pick you up. Now she tried to come one time, but she got in a car accident, so she couldn't come. So when he called again and said, okay, come down, I'm gonna buy you a car. Actually, matter of fact, I bought you a car. Come on down, and I'm gonna make sure that you get it, and we're gonna spend some time together. So she's thinking, okay. Again, what's the vulnerability? Probably looking for love in all the wrong places, right? So she gets the Greyhound bus, she comes to Atlanta, he picks her up at the bus down station right downtown Atlanta. When he picks her up, it's not in the car he bought her, so she's like, what's going on? He's in some kind of taxi cab. He takes her to Fulton Industrial Boulevard. She has no idea what Fulton Industrial is. She's not from here. She gets to Fulton Industrial Boulevard, and he goes, well, you're going to have to go inside to the ATM to get to this gas station. You got to go inside to the ATM and get some money to pay for this tax debt. Now she's really freaking out. And then all of a sudden, she sees he has a gun in his hip. And so she said, well, let me just do this. So she gets out. She goes into the gas station. She gets some money for the ATM. She comes out. She pays for it. And then he gets out and tells her, this is what you're going to do. And he literally makes her walk that track, picking up men. Men would take her to the warehouse behind, some certain warehouses out there on Fulton Industrial, and make her commit sexual acts for money. And she had to come back and give that money to him. She's crying. She's like, I don't know how to do this. And he's really threatening her. So by the time she does a few acts, then he takes her to his home. I want to say the home was in College Park. Takes her to his home, takes her upstairs where he sexually assaults her, and he releases her the next morning. The good thing is she has a phone, and her phone, she was able to get a message off on Facebook to her family. So her family actually called College Park Police Department. And we have this whole body camera, or dash camera, a video of rescue. Because now he kicks her out, and she's walking, and she doesn't know where she is. The police is talking to her on the phone. The police is talking to her mom on the phone. They're trying to find her, and they find her. And they rescue her. By the time we rescue her and we get this case, we find out this man has not only trafficked her, who was 37 years old, but he also had raped and trafficked other people, even a minor who was like 15 or 16 that we found that was out in California, whose case had not been adjudicated or prosecuted. So we brought her case in. This child took about, I don't know, 3 to 4 weeks to try. We had about 4 victims by the time we got done. And so he got sentenced to life without the possibility of the parole plus 75 years. This is where she had to walk. Who knows next? There is certain lingo and language in commercial sex. I had learned this dealing with my survivors. Like when you walk with your head down, you can't look up at any man. Because if you look up at a man, that man now owns you. It's a whole culture that we've had to learn in order to properly prosecute these cases. These are real people, guys. This is not like some case file. These are real people in real lives. And I have never been in a situation like that. Most of us have never been in a situation like that. So we have to understand their backstory to be able to help them. He deceived her. He took her, used her, he also raped her. Then this young lady is the young lady that was working in the drive-thru that I told you about. She was 19 years of age. She wasn't from Atlanta. This young lady was 14 years old, who was trafficked by her aunt. Her aunt was into commercial sex. Her aunt was in the life. And in order for them to survive, she said, well, you know, we got to get a hotel room. I got nowhere to stay. We're going to have to make some money. She was 14, but she was introduced to the life when I'm 13. And we've worked with her. Michelle, my investigator, have worked with her. And we believe she's still in the life. We try so hard, sometimes it's so hard. And we try to bring in non-governmental organizations and who can help us with the advocacy for them to get them services and skills and things like that so they don't have to go back to it. Because she told my investigator, look, why would I need to work a job making what?
$17
an hour, and I can make $300 in a minute. My youngest victims were 8 and 7 years old, who were trafficked by their mother. They were sold to a 75-year-old man for sex. The man went to trial, he was convicted and sent away for the rest of his life. These two victims were from an undercover case. One of them from South Carolina, the other young lady was from here. This intersected with the criminal street gangs, which is a big thing now. Criminal street gangs, normally you think about drugs and guns. That's true, but now they're finding it's more profitable to traffic people because I can use a person over and over again without having to go get more product. It's the person I can use over and over again. This particular guy had a music video. He was saying he's a rapper. We found all his music videos. One of the music videos that he had a 17-year-old victim in it, naked, and he was talking about pimping. He was also a gang member. And so there was a lot of fear about coming forward, moving forward with a case like this, because gang members have a large reach. And so we have to be really careful when we prosecute those cases, but we're doing it. Yes. Human trafficking may be one of the least understood crimes in the United States. It's so widespread, it's so profitable, and the conversations are hard. We have to talk about sex. We also have to talk about people who buy the sex.
Thank you.
Because if there is no demand, maybe there won't be the supply. And so we prosecuted our first buyer last year in October, and he was sentenced to life.
Thank you.
And he had actually raped our victim who was into commercial sex at the hand of someone else. And this guy purchased her. And we prosecuted him for trafficking. That's allowed under Georgia statute. Our community suffers when our children are exploited. We lose positive contributions that they could otherwise be making, and then it costs us money to reintroduce them back into society because we have to now figure out how to rehabilitate their thinking, the background in their mind. They're totally, they're traumatized, and the trauma has impacted how they respond to life. So now we've got to go in and figure out how can we restore them, restore their self-esteem, their self-worth. The saddest thing I heard was I had a victim tell me she had two traffickers and they were both physically abusing her. And I said, well, they got to go to jail, honey. They did these things to you. And she said, well, this one was nicer. He didn't beat me as much. That, like, he loved me more than the other. Well, neither one of them loved you, sweetheart. And so it's an interesting work. It's a hard work, but it's going to take a community. It's going to take all of us to wrap our arms around this and deal with some real hard facts. The community bears the cost. So if you don't look for it, you don't find it. I'm really blessed to have some law enforcement partners that will do undercover operations. We've got a lot of our cases from undercover ops. They'll be proactive and looking for it. So hard to find. You really have to look for it. So they'll put on scenes where they go through and they look at commercial sex ads, anyone advertising on a Craigslist. There's several apps where things are done, where they're selling sex, and so they'll target those ads, call those people in, and they'll end up having a big bust of folks that are involved with commercial sex. We work with service providers. It's going to take our pastors and religious leaders and parents. It's going to take all of us. So what should we look for? And these are just a few. When you think of human trafficking, I want you to think of who's vulnerable. Think about the people in your life. Think about your family members in your life. I mean, if your kid or somebody's kid is all of a sudden withdrawing from the family, withdrawing into themselves, you know, might want to go ask some questions. You see a kid, you know that they don't have much means. They come to school, but they have all the most expensive things. Got to start asking some questions. You know, and then if you see something, I'd rather you say something than not say anything at all. Give us an opportunity to look into it to see if that child or that person needs to be recovered or brought out of the life. Defects, custody is a huge, huge filter for, unfortunately, for kids who are exploited. Many of my kids have been in defects custody somewhere or another, which means that there's no real parental support at home. So they're living with people in foster cares, or they're in group homes, and they're running away. They're frequent flyers. They're always running. And they find themselves in the street trying to take care of themselves, and they run across the wrong person. A history of sexual abuse, I would say about 80% of my victims have been sexually abused prior to their exploitation. That is by family members or someone. That opens them up for it to be vulnerable for this kind of stuff. History of drug addiction, unstable living conditions, and when a girl or a boy is trafficked, their control is taken. Their ability to make a decision on what to eat, what to wear, where to go, when to go, who to call, who not to call. It's manipulation at its best. It's mental manipulation. And so when you have people in your family, again, they start to change, ask questions. Just ask questions. I'm not saying everybody is trafficked. I know my kids get tired of me saying, Mom, I'm not being trafficked. I'm always asking questions. Ask questions. Talk to me. Go to the next slide. So that's generally what I'm dealing with, what we're dealing with, I think, across the country. I mean, I sit on a statewide task force that reaches nationwide, and I talk to other prosecutors in other jurisdictions like New York, California, South Carolina, you name it, and we're seeing some of the same things. But I want to stop here and open it up for any questions you have, because I really want you all to understand what we're doing, what we're looking at, what we're doing, and how we can tackle it. Yes.
Thank you so much. When you are atypical, I'm a lawyer, you are atypical. Let me give you some examples. I formed a group called Moms, Mothers of Many, to tell about children who were being trafficked. Mm-hmm. And we would go to court. But this white man was trafficking a 5-year-old, and the white district attorney wouldn't do nothing about it. Okay, that was one instance. Hank and I lived beside in a community where we found a young black girl being raped by hand of shade. I give you, had him arrested. The cops told me he was too old to go to jail. These are actual incidents. The third one was teachers. This one I want to address. A lot of trafficking takes place with teachers, and I had one case where this teacher took three girls, 12 and 13, to the hotel. The school system allowed him to resign without anything in his record. And what I found out through the years, a lot of these girls that have been trafficked in schools have no records. So I'm not questioning, how can you get just returners on another case, girl was raped, and I offered to try the case. The district attorney said, oh no, we're going to do justice. She was gang raped. But he allowed these young men, 20 years old, to plead as youthful offenders, and they never spent a day in jail. So I found problems with prosecutors and police officers and school systems. So have you had problems in trying to get help for these children from school systems and DAs outside of progressive DAs like you? Because over the past 50 years, we've had a lot of problems. It's refreshing to see you.
I appreciate that. Well, I stand on the shoulders of giants. I say that. My district attorney is Fonda Willis, and we really got to and we're not afraid to do what we have to do. Now, in terms of me interacting with other district attorney's offices, I mean, I interact with different district attorney's offices. I don't know the underworkings of how they handle their cases. I can only speak to how we handle ours. But in terms of schools, the big part that we have to play is not only prosecutors and holding traffickers accountable and getting justice, is that we have to do this, education and awareness. And so I have to get out, and I've done this, we go out into the schools. We have programs in our office where we are going out into the schools to have these conversations. And I also let them know that we're looking for these cases. So you're kind of watchdogging at the same time, if you understand what I'm saying. So you got your SROs, so your student resource officers who are out there on the campus that are supposed to make record of things that are going on. You've got your school counselors who are supposed to make record of things that are going on. And it's our job to make sure when we have cases that involve kids who are in school is to go get those records and see what's going on and make an assessment and adjustment as needed. But I can't speak to other jurisdictions. I just know that in 2024, and I've been doing this for the last 6 years, we're not afraid to try a case, even the hard ones, we're not afraid to do it. It's just, you need to make sure you have a progressive DA, and that, it goes to election. That goes to people being involved in the election process. You gotta vote for your electeds. You can't overlook the people that are taking office and their stance on crime. And so, I'm so sorry to hear that somebody had a case where someone was a gang rape and they just kind of turned a blind eye. I just can't imagine that. Rapes are hard to prove in the first place. They're hard to prove because they're happening behind closed doors and there are no witnesses. So we rely heavily on the outcry of a victim. We rely heavily on any kind of corroborating, any evidence to support what they're saying. But at the end of the day, we still have to try. we still have to fight. And I hope that when you see something like that, that you're reporting that, and that we're holding your electeds accountable for lack of doing their job, basically.
See, I think that school boards should be accountable.
That's right.
Because
they are elected.
Every time there's a complaint, it should be documented.
Absolutely.
And they allow these teachers to resign, and there's nothing on that, because they go to another school and do it again.
Yeah.
I'm sure that's a problem in Georgia too.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. And again, if you don't say something about it, so it can be investigated and looked upon, I don't know how we're going to learn about it. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't see it.
Shouldn't she be able to actually escalate this up to the Justice Department, not in that state, but the Justice Department for Washington, D.C., to have an investigation, to have them investigate that DA department?
If it's in Washington, D.C., I don't know about their laws, but I would always say you want a paper trail. You started with the teacher, you started with the counselor, or whoever, you started with the supervisor, then you went to the superintendent. You want a paper trail that you went from person to person to person saying, address this, address this, address this, before you get up there. Because that way you have a paper trail and you have some kind of evidence to back up a lack of someone not doing their job. Yes.
Thank you so much, and thank you for this insightful information. I was just curious if you could speak a little bit more about some of the offenders. So the folks who are actually receiving the services. I know you said you just prosecuted one, but of the current cases that you're working on now, how many of those involve the actual receivers of these sex acts, et cetera, and what more is being done to prosecute them? Because like you said, if there is no demand, there's no need for supply.
So I would say as of 2022 is when we really began to talk about buyer demand, to be honest. It's been a walk. We've had to take this thing in stages. We had to get people even used to the thought of people selling their bodies for sex for money and being wrong. You know, we always got this, well, you know, prostitution is the oldest profession in the world. I mean, that's the mentality that we're fighting.
Yeah.
So now, if you can imagine fighting that mentality, and then now we're talking about buyers, because it's like, well, that's no big deal. He just bought the sex. It's not a big deal. That's what people do. And we're like, no, that's not okay. If they're a minor, that's not okay. If they're a person who were deceived into or coerced into, that's not okay. And so those conversations that I can recall started back in 2022. Unfortunately, our law enforcement officers, they were arresting traffickers, recovering victims, but they weren't getting information on the people, let's say in the cell phones, that made the deal. They just kind of let that go. So it's just now heightening awareness. Under Georgia law specifically, we can go after buyers. And so that's a recent conversation. And so of the cases that I've had, I think I've had two cases so far where we've dealt with buyers because, you know, I need my agencies. In Fulton County, we've got about 13, 14 agencies that report to our office. I need them to be aware to know. I need you to go after them to get their information too. Let's make arrests there as well so that we can say, you know, when we prosecute them, we have a conviction. We can say, hey, this is not what we're going to do in Atlanta. It's not what we're going to do in Georgia. And this is what's going to happen if you buy sex. So that's a recent conversation, very recent conversation. It's been progressive. And we're trying to get people's mind around, hey, this is not right. This is not right. Because if I can deal with demand, I can probably help now lower supply. They got to do something else. Right?
Good question. Thank you.
Oh, yes.
Sorry, one more.
Okay.
Yes. Thanks for sharing this. And it is difficult to talk about. But and I'm glad that you mentioned, because as you mentioned, it's the international issue. And the fact it's $150 billion, we're so glad you monetize that. That is absolutely disgusting. And I think that there needs to be more to say about, you know, whoever these buyers are, you know, this is wrong, and, you know, like, really get that into their head. And it's just not like an entertainment type of thing. But my question revolves around this issue of consent. You know, I live in Texas, which has its own stories still. But as far as, like, you know, child brides and also the age of consent, like being 16. 16 or 15 or whatever it is in that regard too. Do you know if there's any movement afoot to like maybe raise that a little bit? Because I understand that in some instances, if a person is 4 years older than that, like 16, you know, there's like, okay, you can only date, you can only have sex with somebody who's like a certain age, it's legal. That's all the stuff, you know, 21-year-old does not need to be, you know, interacting with a teenager. You know, so just curious as far as like if there's any movement afoot to like actually deal with these issues of, you know, 13, 14, 15-year-olds being married, that's legal. And sorry, I'm ranting, but this is really something that's very, you know, like, what? And then also the issue, I heard you say something about harboring people, you know, in the home.
Yes.
So then there's also the issue of people who are being molested at home.
That's right.
You know, so if someone's being molested in their home, is that also, are they considered being harbored even though it could be a relative?
Okay, so let me break that down in pieces, because you said
I know.
No,
it was a
I tried it. I think I got everything you said.
She was on the
road. She was.
I appreciate it.
Okay, so let me start with the age.
Thank you.
Okay. So, and I can say this state of Georgia, and I think you can federal, but state of Georgia, anyone under 18, they cannot consent to commercial sex. 18, under 18. If you're 17 and under, no, it's a no. Let's make that clear. 18 and under, 18 and under. When it comes to sexual acts, that's a different age for consent. So if someone is charged with rape or some kind of sexual assault, the age of consent in Georgia is 16. It is, it's 16. So when I'm making decisions on how things are charged, I know what my trafficking, if anything happens to a kid under 18, we're done. But when I'm talking about any kind of sexual violence, or sexual assault, child molestation, if the kid is 16, that's an age of consent, and that brings me to a different level of like standard and proof that I have to work with, because that kid now is legally able to consent in terms of sex. And so whether there's legislation working on that or not, I have not seen any legislation to change that. I know that states are getting really tough on trafficking, so which is why you have the larger age window. But just like sexual behaviors, it's 16 for age of consent for sex. Now I'm talking about that clause when they're 4 years older, it's called the Romeo and Juliet clause that has to deal with young people who are, you know, 16, well they're not 16, let's say that they're, well, let's say they're 15. And then if someone is 4 years older than them, the law looks at them as they still kind of kids. And so they're going to deal with that person that they had sex with from that perspective of, can we rehabilitate these people back into society, give them services and things like that. And so the penalty is less for that reason because they consider them to still be mentally children.
Right.
But that's the reason for that Romeo and Juliet clause. Now, I will say there are certain instances where depending on the nature of the assault, you know, violent rape, we still can do what we can do. We still can do what we gotta do. It doesn't matter about the consent. If it's forcible rape, you know, I don't care if we're at the age of consent. If I got evidence that's forcible rape, then that's a 25 to life crime. So now we do what we have to do. But I hope I tackled those because I think it's important to note that, again, when you're talking about trafficking, 16, no, I'm sorry. You're going